the previous panel with Chancellor Farina, I mentioned that I'm concerned about the renewal school program and obviously the teacher's job. She had mentioned that there is some interaction about the future fate of the teachers, and there's some discussion about where they will go in the future. I wanted to hear from this panel, has there been any interaction with the Chancellor on the future fate of those teachers that are in the schools that are going to be merged, consolidated, or closed under the renewal program?
When we have discussions with them in previous years on those issues, we have been able to make sure that all those teachers were placed in schools. The idea that you punish a school and you say a school's not achieving, I understand accountability, and then could say that it, you know, for years when I came up here, I was, you know, the line was that the school's failing because the teachers are failing, right? And we would get very angry when we were here testifying about that. For us, the renewal program is something that is extremely important, and we want to make sure that we don't, the last thing we want to happen is to say to a teacher, we need you in a school that's struggling, and we want you to go there and take on this challenge. And in the end, if it doesn't work out, we're gonna punish you for going to that school. That's the last thing we want to happen. And that's what was happening in New York City and in different districts across this state. So now, this administration has, they are in agreement. So when a school in the renewal program needs to close or consolidate, we have been able to work out the situations on the placement of those instructors. And I thank those instructors for going to that school, because a lot of them, you know, we have close to 4,000 transfers a year inside of New York City, and they choose to stay in those difficult situations because they their relationships with their students. And that's the part that was not being recognized a couple of years ago, and I appreciate that. I know this body did recognize it.
Both of your testimonies, you had mentioned the importance of teacher centers, UFT, you put in your legislative priorities, appreciate the sheet. What are the real possible effects if the $5 million are not restored to the teacher centers?
Right now, just take the one issue I brought up, which was the professional hours, or as they're known, if you ever hear the acronym CTLE, that's what they mean by the professional hours that are now mandated. We're supplying more of those hours than anyone else. The teacher centers are doing it, and it was not something that was in their plan. It just became that all of a sudden, teachers were now, teachers and paraprofessionals and different pedagogues are now under this requirement, and the only people who were giving the classes, who were certified to give the classes, were for-profit institutions. And they were the ones who started with the, you know, $300, $250 for a two-hour course, $300 for a three-hour course. And that's, right now, that would be the biggest piece. The second thing is, we really have a plan in place to roll out the new standards and educate people on them before they get put into place. Something we did not do with the last standards change. And we know how that happened. So, and I give the Board of Regents and SED all the credit for coming up with a plan, and they have been meeting with the teacher centers and working with them on how to have this public rollout and education on all of this. So now we're trying to not repeat the debacle of the Common Core and cause all of that craziness that happened in our state. You have this entity known as teacher centers that seem to be the hub working with the agency responsible to try to roll this out and educate people. To me, this is the easiest no-brainer of the year, because that should be something we should be trying to avoid, which is another disaster in terms of a rollout of a new standards platform.
And lastly, with seconds remaining, lastly, you both in both testimonies you mentioned revenue generating ideas and suggestions. I really appreciate that. It's not so much just asking for more money. You gave ideas about revenue generating, but I'm going to ask another question about, do you know of any cost savings or cuts that we could make? Maybe there's wasteful spending in this portion of the budget. Any suggestions for cost saving or wasteful spending cuts?
We haven't really spent too much time on cost savings, really just looking at the entire system and how the multimillionaires are basically getting the windfall of the tax cuts federally, and I think that that would be a great place for us to look for something for this year. I mean, we have the millionaire's tax. I would look at the multimillionaires or the billionaire's tax. That might be nice.
We look forward to having any conversation, both at a local level or a state level, about things. As we know, we are going to be facing more and more challenges from the federal government, and you guys are really facing a very difficult challenge because of what many of the residents of our state might be facing next year because of the federal legislation. We look forward to having those conversations and working with anyone on it.
Again, thank you very much.
Thank you.